Thank you guys for being here. I'm real excited this year. The theme is Robert E. Howard and the comics, and this is something that a lot of us are interested in, and it's taken a while to kind of find a way to make this work. I'm Mark Finn. I'm a frogman and an astronaut. With me on the panel today is my buddy Jeff Shanks, who is doing great stuff in the academic circles. He's currently the co-chair of the PCAACA Pulp Studies group that is responsible for putting on academic presentations every year with a Robert E. Howard bent. Next to him is our guest of honor, someone I've been a fan of for years, and I'm so excited that he's here, Tim Truman. Big hand for the guest of honor. Yes. Longtime scribe on Dark Horse's Conan stories, and currently the guy putting King Conan together for us in Hour of the Dragon. I'm so excited about that. And last but certainly not least, our wayward Scott, Mr. Al Harron on the end there. Thank you very much. We actually have a lot to talk about, and so we're going to try and just kind of go roughly as, I won't say as fast as we can, but there's a broad overview here because there's an awful lot of stuff that maybe you guys don't know, maybe you do, and we're going to try to cover it as quickly as we possibly can because I want to have some time left over for questions, and anything that we don't get to, we'll just roll into the next panel down the road. But for now, we're going to start with Robert E. Howard in the comics, and I think you may be surprised at what Jeff has uncovered here. Take it away, bro.
All right. Well, you know, most people, when they think about Robert E. Howard in the comics, think that that story starts in 1970 with Conan the Barbarian. But actually, there's a history of Robert E. Howard in comics going back at least two decades before that, or almost two decades before that. It's kind of interesting because you would think, comics sort of developed out of the pulps, and a lot of the pulp genres were transformed into comics right away, you know, detective stories and even, you know, aviation and war and all of those. But sword and sorcery, it took a while before you saw a comic version of the sword and sorcery genre. You know, you had, you did have things like Arthurian, you know, stories like Prince Valiant and mythological figures and that sort of thing, but it really wasn't until 1950 that you first saw the beginnings of true Howardian sword and sorcery in the comics. And that was a series called Crom the Barbarian. And it first appeared in Out of This World. There was a no number, one shot issued by Avon. And Crom was done by John Gienta did the art, and Gardner F. Fox wrote the story. And so some of you may probably know Gardner Fox from his flash stories in the beginning of the Silver Age, but he actually wrote prose sword and sorcery stories as well. So Crom is very much, you know, obviously there's the name Crom in the title, but you know, if you read it, it's you get Set in there and Ophir and, you know, a number of Howardian name dropping in there. So clearly was influenced by Howard. Now in 1951, after Crom, you had King Cole made his first appearance in comics. People don't realize this.
Yes, he did.
He appeared in Captain Marvel.
Yay!
You know, there was a King Cole character that appeared in 1951, and he was a barbarian king of an antediluvian empire 28,000 years ago that was frozen in suspended animation and woken up, you know. Yeah. Now, lest you think this is a coincidence, the guy that was writing Captain Marvel at the time was Otto Bender. So, for those who know Bender, he was a pulp writer back in the day. He worked for the Otis Adelbert Klein agency. He was a big fan of Howard's. He was selling Howard, you know, pitching Howard stories in 35 and 36. You know, he was one that probably got him in Argosy and some of that. There's a pretty good case that he might have been the posthumous collaborator that finished Amulric. So Bender was a Howard fan, and he saw a way to sort of sneak a, you know, quasi Howard character into Captain Marvel in 1951. Now, 1952 brought about the first true Howard comic book,
but it was an unauthorized bootleg in Mexico. It was Conan, and it was a series called La Reina de Costa Negra, the Queen of the Black Coast. And it started out, it adapted Howard's story, Queen of the Black Coast, and then started doing pastiche material after that. Belit survived in this version to go on to have other adventures. And these are incredibly rare, and some of these, their existence has only really been discovered in the last few years. But this was what the first issue looked like. This is the first appearance of Conan in comic books, November 1952, 18 years before Marvel's Conan. And these things are really rare. This 19 early 50 series in Mexico, they were small size. They ran for about 40 or 50 issues. In these, Conan is blonde. Belit is really the main character, and Conan is sort of her sidekick. Kind of the barbarian boy toy that's, her muscle, so to speak.
That's nice work if you can get it.
Yeah. There's worse fate. They were running in this series called Cuentos de Abuelito. My Spanish is not very good, so y'all can correct my pronunciation, but it's something like Grandfather's Stories or Tales from Grandfather. And it was kind of an anthology series. They did a few other things. They had Kunga, the Golden Goddess, and she was sort of a Sheena knockoff, blonde jungle queen. They had the Mad Monk, and they had La Araña, which was another unauthorized bootleg of the Spider, the pulp hero of the Spider. So clearly, whoever was making these, and we really don't know much about them, they were probably fans of American pulps, and they were finding a way to, using these pulp characters, making bootleg, unauthorized stories down in Mexico.
Now, why did they stop making them, Jeff?
Well, yeah, we'll get to that. Where's those 50s? Show up. I was going to show some of them. They were actually swiping Joe Kubert in the late 50s. They were swiping his Viking Prince stories from Brave and the Bold. In the 60s, you can see some of those larger issues there. Whoops. They started reprinting them in the mid-60s. Let's see if I got a few here. In regular comic book size. This series ran in 1965 and 1966. And at this point, somebody told L. Sprague de Camp that this publisher in Mexico was putting out Conan comics. And this is in 1966, right, when he was just about to bring out the first Lancer. So DeCamp wrote him a letter, just curious, asked him about him, and they never responded, and publication stopped, and that was the end of it. And so they were actually really lost to fandom. Nobody, DeCamp didn't really tell anybody about it. Nobody knew about it until the 70s when one or two issues started popping up, and ever since then, researchers have been working to try and figure out how many there are. There's a number of issues that have never been seen, but...
Have you seen a copy of the letter that he sent?
No, I only know that secondhand. Jonathan Bacon, a Ray Hoopin member back in the 70s, wrote about it in his zine. So even that story about DeCamp is secondhand and maybe kind of apocryphal. We don't really know. It makes for a good story though. Now, in 1968, this is the first authorized Robert E. Howard comic, and a lot of people don't even know about this. This was sort of a prozine or semi-prozine that was done by the Texas Trio. That's Larry Herndon and Buddy Saunders from My Comic Shop, Lone Star Comics. And they did an adaptation of Gods of the North in 1968. And this one, they did get permission. In the intro there, they thank Glenn Lord for giving them the permission to reprint this story. My guess is they probably wanted to do a Conan story, but by this point, the Lancers were out, and so the closest they could get was doing Gods of the North, which is, some of you know, is a sort of version of Frost Giant's Daughter, but with a different, different character. They changed the main character to Amra instead of Conan. So that gets us up to where most people think Robert E. Howard comics began, with Marvel in 1970. Even before Conan, you had Star the Slayer, which was a sort of Conan prototype by Roy Thomas and Barry Windsor Smith. It was one story that appeared in Chamber of Darkness, number 4, in 1970, a few months before Conan number 1 appeared. And you can see, you can see the artwork there. Let's see if some of y'all can see it. It looks just like Barry Windsor Smith's Conan that he would do a couple months later with the horned helmet and everything. So this was sort of a prototype where they were working on
it. Their plan was to see if Windsor Smith or Barry Smith at the time was a good was a good fit for it.
Right. So with that, I'm gonna turn it over to Mark to take over the history of Marvel and the story of where things start there.
When Roy Thomas was here a few years ago, he talked about this, and of course, you know, Roy has been a champion and an advocate for Howard for a long time, and a lot of people came to Howard through those Conan comics and the Savage Swords. I mean, that was one of the big gateways to Robert E. Howard's work, and certainly that was something that led. There's almost a straight line from the comics to the Schwarzenegger movie. I think everybody's heard the story about how Roy wanted to get the Conan rights because he'd read the Lancers and loved them and thought they were great and thought they would make good comics, and Stan Lee didn't want to do it. And in fact, Stan Lee was more interested in Throngor because he liked the name better.
And he could get it cheaper.
Because Throngor already sounds like Badoom and Fin Fang Foom and all the other monsters.
Yeah. The names that Stan Lee loved, you know.
So it was, and you got to admit, Throngor, that could have been a fire lizard. Why not? So Roy insisted. And Stan didn't really come around to it until issue number 4. He let Stan read a copy of Tower of the Elephant, and Stan's reply was, "Is this selling?" "Yeah, Stan, it's selling really well." "Well, I don't understand it, but okay." And so, you know, I don't think he ever really saw the appeal, but it's kind of to his credit that he didn't, because he let Roy alone. And so Roy kind of had a free hand to develop this as he saw fit. And it was really the first big contribution that Roy has to the Marvel Universe. And now we consider that the first Conan comic is the start of the Bronze Age of comics, if you buy into that nomenclature. Real soon after that, Roy started trying to expand the efforts. The first thing that came out around the same time as the Conan stories did, they just started doing Conan. He got the idea of running a Kull story in one of their Marvel's monster reprint magazines, Creatures on the Loose. And I'll say this: over the years, present company included, the Robert E. Howard characters and comics have always been blessed with an amazing array of talented artists. And so it's not by accident that Bernie Wrightson was the guy that got to draw the first Kull comic. And it's gorgeous.
It's his first job.
Yeah. It was a big deal, you know. At the time, he'd been doing a lot of fanzine work. Mm-hmm. And so Roy threw this at him to see if he could do it. And he turned in an amazing job. Shortly after that, Curtis Magazines, which was owned by Timely before they became Marvel Magazines proper, put out Black and White Savage Tales. And this had Black and White Conan stories. And again, Roy was putting ringers in as quickly as possible, you know, because I think he was really... You know, Conan went fast, and people got it. And it was the same people reading the Lancers that were reading these comics. This was just after Marvel Pop Art Productions, when Stan found out that the comics were being read and discussed on college campuses. So this is the same audience buying these comics. And he wasted no time in trying to sort of get other things. And, of course, this was all Glenn doing this, you know, of course. And basically throw in Roy whatever he could. After the Savage Tales experiment they didn't sell super good, which is why we only got, was it three of them?
Five.
Yeah. But it didn't stop Roy from putting other comic book stories into the other reprints. Journey to Mystery number 1 in 1972 did an adaptation of Dig Me No Grave. And he's running this right alongside the Ditko reprints and the Kirby stuff. Let's just put a new story in there and see what happens. and he was clocking the mail, seeing what he could get. You know, the Cull comics had kind of gotten a little traction, and he was running Cull stories wherever he could. Of course, John Severin was the early artist on that. And again, you know, what a guy to do those Culls. I mean, he set the visual template. You know, in the Robert E. Howard stories, Cull doesn't have that scar.
Right.
That was done to sort of differentiate him from Conan. And my thinking is they needn't have bothered. I mean, you know, the way Severin drew Cull, there was no mistaking, you know, who he was. So it was a really, the Cull stories did good, but they never quite sold as well as Conan, didn't quite catch on. But Roy believed in it and kept pushing it. 1973, there were a number of things that came out. Chamber of Chills did an adaptation of Horror from the Mound called Monster from the Mound. And that was Roy Thomas doing it with Frank Bruner artwork. Again, he's putting these guys with lush brushwork who do these really great romantic figures and using them as artists on these projects to try and elevate the name. That was followed by Valley of the Worm, which was a Thomas plot and a Gary Conway script with art by Gil Kane. And, you know, a lot of people don't like Gil Kane, but Gil Kane was an amazing draftsman. And this is one of the better things that he did. And you can tell he really got into it.
And he had been doing, he had done his own Sword and Sorcery comic, Black Mark.
Right, you know, and he had just come off of the fill-in issues of Conan,
right.
And they gave him Valley of the Worm, and it's I think it's one of the better things he did.
I think it's one of the best Howard adaptations.
Yeah. It's so strong, and so it everything's there, and it's all in one story. This is back when there was a, you know, you had to get it in one issue, and you know it had to be 22 pages, and Roy was a master at condensing. We got in 73 we also got Monsters Unleashed number one, which was the Skulls and the Stars. That was the first Solomon Kane by Roy Thomas and Alan Weiss. Weiss was another one of these guys who was it Reese? Well, you may Reese did those, but Alan Weiss did the first one, I think.
The Solomon Kane?
Yeah.
Weiss did, yeah.
It was Weiss, yeah. Reese did, but
did a bunch of them.
Reese did too. Yeah, everybody, that was one, that was part of the Krusty Bunkers guys that Neil Adams put together, and so they jammed on all that stuff. All of this was a build-up to 1974, which is when they finally, he had enough momentum that they felt that they could launch the Black and White Conan comics as Savage Sword of Conan, which is where everybody kind of gets on board. And still, Roy was running backups. He had King Cull, he had Bran McMoran, he had Solomon Kane. Worms in the Earth appeared in 1976, and that was the adaptation that was done that is still one of just the absolute best things ever.
Yeah, Conrad.
Tim Conrad did the art on that, and it's just amazing.
And actually, the first, I think, Barry Smith started it.
Yeah, he did the first page or two, he did the first thing,
and then Conrad finished it off.
Which are mind-blowing.
Yes.
Roman soldier being crucified on the ground, downshot.
There it is right there.
Do you have that double-page spread?
Yeah. Yeah, right there is the
And those came out. Those came out in black and white, and they just sing, you know. And by this time, you had a big boom going on in comics. Sword and Sorcery in general was out. DC had done Nightmaster. They were running Warlord. Marvel was going to do Weird World, Claw, Throngor. All this stuff was out. Yeah. And Conan was leading the charge on that. In 1976, Marvel Premiere did a two-issue adaptation of Red Shadows by Howard Chaykin. We're not supposed to call him Howie anymore. No, he gets mad. He'll yell at you. 1980, Epic Magazine ran Al Murick with Roy Thomas and Tim Kirk. It's around this time that the Conan movie broke open, and you know, Conan was everywhere after this. So it was kind of surprising in 1985 when we got the Sword of Solomon Kane six-issue miniseries from Marvel, and it was a mix of old and new stories. Ralph Macchio did some of the stuff. Noteworthy about that, early Mike Mignola artwork. if you're a Mignola fan, he did a couple of those stories, and they're beautiful. There were also Conan graphic novels coming out. Roy was writing original graphic novels that were getting painted treatments. Beautiful stuff. The next high watermark is 1988. Eclipse Comics, out of nowhere and with very little fanfare, published a graphic novel of Pigeons from Hell with Scott Hampton adapting and painting the story. And I think that's also in the top five best adaptations of Howard's work ever in any medium. He nails it. It's chilling. It works as well as the prose piece does, and conveys that sense of isolation. There's a lot of quiet panels in this, where you just have to kind of take the art in and go. By the 1990s, actually, Dark Horse gets into the act here for the first time. In 1989, they did a Kings of the Night two-part story. Again, Roy was doing stuff with Gary Barker on the artwork. And then in 1990, they followed up with a Cormac Mac art miniseries. Kind of surprising. But this was a different Dark Horse back then. They were still doing black and white comics. Dark Horse was just getting their foot in the door. I don't really know much about those deals, they're hit or miss. The Cormac McCart things, I think, are better. By the time you got into the 90s, the Marvel series were winding down. Both Savage Sword and Conan had sort of flatlined in sales. They gave up the ghost in 94. Marvel kept trying to restart Conan, and it never really quite took off or did the only thing that there is a significant period at the end of the Conan run where they were trying different artists, and for those of you who like the Del Rey Swordwoman collection, you should go back and get John Watkiss's run on Conan. It's beautiful. Some of my favorite Conan art from that time period. But it sort of played out. You know, the Conan had kind of become formulaic. I mean, they'd long since run out of stuff, original material to adapt. And Roy adapted everything that he could possibly to make a Conan story, you know, which was sort of the thing at the time. It was okay to do. And it took a while because shortly after that, they sold the rights to Stan Lee's company. And then Conan kind of bounced around for years. And this is what we think of as the Dark Ages. Well, because Howard's Conan wasn't on the bookshelves. The only Conan you could get was by Roland Green and all these other guys. There weren't any Conan comics being put out. It was really kind of a dry hole, you know. The Bane series is sort of the only thing that was kind of like a light in the darkness. But comics had sort of run their course. Oh, before I turn this over and we start talking about Dark Horse, those of you who are interested in the Pigeons from Hell graphic novel, you can't find it anywhere. And when you do, it's expensive. It has been reprinted in a book called The Mammoth Book of Zombie Comics. It's in black and white, so you lose a little of the cool, moody blue artwork. But if you want to see that story, it's part of a giant one of these tomes, The Mammoth Book of Zombie Comics. If you don't have Pigeons from Hell, you probably should buy that book just for that story because it's that good. So it really isn't until 2004 that Dark Horse picks up the ball and starts doing Conan again, and they did it with sort of the idea that we're going to start with Conan, but we want to do Solomon Kane, we want to do Cull, and let's kind of see where this goes. I think Kurt Busiek did a great job initially. And
somebody who didn't know the character, especially.
Yeah, well,
I didn't realize that.
To Kurt's credit, once he got the gig, he joined the Robert E. Howard inner circle online and started talking to people. Mm-hmm. And he and I had several conversations about Howard and Conan, and I know he talked to other people as well. And of course, Jim and Ruth Keegan reached out to him and said, "What do you need?" And so he did his homework, which is. Again, I'm grateful to him for doing that because I think he set the template.
Yeah.
And so when he left the book, they were looking for a successor. And this is where Tim comes in. Do you want to talk a little bit about how you got the gig?
Yeah, if you're at the banquet tonight, you'll hear a bit of retreaded. But I'd picked up a couple of issues of Kurt and Carrie's Conan's that Dark Horse was doing, and I was like, hey, this is pretty good. And I wasn't really expecting much because I'm a real Howard snob, believe it or not. But so I'm extra critical on this stuff. And I liked them. So I just called up the editor who I knew, Scott Alley, and just tell him, hey, man, I'm really enjoying this. And if you need any covers or anything, I'd love to contribute. And Scott wasn't in the office at the time. He was at a convention. But his assistant said, oh, I'll let him know. And I really didn't expect to hear back from them, because I knew that everybody in the, every artist and writer in the world would be calling, hey, let me do something, you know. And, but the next Monday, I got a call from Scott, and he said, yeah, we'd like to see you do something. And he said, in fact, we've been talking to Joe R. Lansdale, too. And Joe and I had done Jonah Hex and Lone Ranger and Tonto, and Scott had really enjoyed that. So he said, do you think you work on it together? So, and Joe R. Lansdale happens to be here right in the front row.
His own self.
But, I said, yeah, man, that sounds great. So anyway, Joe and I got it together, and we started to work on Conan and Songs of the Dead. And it was like, how many issues? Like four or six, something like that?
Four, I think.
Yeah.
Was it five?
Five.
Okay, so we what do we know?
Yeah, right. Yeah, we were just there. But anyway. So I was a couple issues into it, and really difficult job because I wanted it to be good, and I'm seldom good. But anyway, so I was a couple issues into it, and they gave me a call. Carrie Nord, amazing artist, but he really, really, really had trouble with deadlines. And so he was having one of those times where he was really, really, really having trouble. They said, could you do a couple of fill-in issues that Kurt would write? And I said, I didn't really want to break from Songs of the Dead, but I said, sure. And so I did these really quick, very, very fast, under pressure, couple of issues for that. And then I went back to working on Songs of the Dead. And so I was working on Songs of the Dead again for like 2 weeks, and they called me again and said, guess what, Kurt's going to leave the book, and he has recommended that you be the one to take it over, because Kurt and I had these really long phone conversations. He'd gotten the impression that I was really into Howard, and sort of it was all in my background, in my genealogy. And Mike Mignola, the artist, had seconded the opinion. So they flew me out to Oregon to talk about being the writer. And I was really reluctant to take the job because, like I said, I'd always been this Conan snob. I'd never read the pastiches, like the Lynn Carter and L. Sprague de Camp's Conan of the Isles and all the Roland Green stuff and the Carl Wagner stuff. I wouldn't read them. And even with Marvel's Conan, I loved them, and I was extremely a fan of them. But they were never, to me, they were Marvel's Conan. They weren't Howard's Conan.
Right.
So that's what I mean about being a snob. I just Robert E. Howard stuff was the stuff I enjoyed. So I didn't want to become one of those guys. And now I'm besides Roy Thomas, I'm the adapter and scripter who's worked on this stuff for longest, it's real heartfelt stuff. But anyway, that's sort of the rambling version of it.
Did they give you any instruction, or did they kind of give you a free hand? I mean,
Scott Alley, the original editor, never gives anyone a free hand, except for Mike Mignola, when Mike Mignola's doing Hellboy.
Right. Yeah.
And it was really difficult working with Scott at first because he would send scripts back to me a lot, and I wasn't quite used to that, and so I ended up having to defend a lot of the stuff that I wanted to do, but I think Scott got fed up with, I love Scott. He's a real good friend and stuff, but he was an extremely difficult editor. We just didn't, you know, there was always this going on. And later on, we passed it. He kept, you know, passing it down to Matt Dreyer, and now my current editor, Philip Simon, who is just like, he's the kind of editor I like to work with because he is really critical about plot points, but he kind of gives Tomas and I free reign. And those issues that I do with Philip and some of the ones I did with Matt are the ones that people gravitate towards and saying, yeah, good job. You know, I wasn't into your stuff until that happened. So whenever I was allowed more free reign, that's, you know, and could like dig back into my sort of Howard impulses and roots, then that's when the stuff was felt good to me, and also I think started reading better for the reader.
You got a groove and hit it.
Mm-hmm.
I understand that trepidation, because I've been sort of kind of the de facto consultant for them for a lot of stuff, and I was always getting emails from Scott or Kurt about would Robert have done this, or is this a good thing for Solomon Kane?
Right.
And so they knew they had me on the hook, and then the day that Samantha Robertson emailed me and said, hey, I'd really like you to write an El Barak story. And I said, mm-hmm. Cool, you want me to adapt one? And she said, no, we want you to do an original one. And I went, oh, shit.
Yeah, that's tough. You become one of those guys.
Because my first thought my first thought was they're going to turn on me.
Yep.
like the last goose at Christmas. You know, yeah.
You know.
Yeah, that was – so I'm familiar with that impulse to go, oh, no, never.
Yeah.
Then I thought, no, are you kidding? It's El Barak.
Yeah. I mean, I'm a fanboy. Well, like Joe jumped right into Conan and the Songs of the Dead, you know, because Joe's Joe.
We'll talk about this on the panel tomorrow. I think the difference is that Joe knows if he's doing a story, he gets to do his story.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And you know, you don't contact him unless, you know.
You want a Joe Lansdale story.
That's right.
Right.
And, but... I mean, I'm a fan.
We'll talk about that.
When I'm a fan of something, I am.
It's hard. Hard to divorce yourself.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's almost like, you know, like coming here was like, please excuse me, I don't mean to get theological here, but it's like a Christian going to Bethlehem.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? That's how deep it is in me.
The church.
Yeah.
Al, you have been listening to basically 55, 65 years of comics. And you know, I know that, and you're doing comics now over in
attempting
Scotland.
Attempting to.
Well, you know, everybody attempts, but you're getting them done. So Al's on this panel because I think what we wanted to kind of discuss for those of you who are not convinced of the strength of comics or the interest in comics, tell us briefly why this stuff is important. What's good about the comics medium that allows for these storytelling opportunities?
Well, I had this all prepared and anyway.
Right. Your ponytail's too tight.
Ponytail's too tight, that's it, my beard's too tight. The turtle's distracting me.
turtles.
Comics has historically been very looked down upon as a medium for decades, since its inception, much like pulp has for a long time, although Jeff and Mark are making great strides in, you've already made great strides and stuff, now you're just continuing.
Yeah.
But comics is still undeservedly got a lot of these hang-ups about it being essentially kid stuff. As if that was a bad thing, but let's not get into that stuff. But comics is an art form that is every bit as nuanced and full of possibilities as literature or cinema or theatre or anything that generally gets given the holy term that is art. Now, the thing about comics is it's an intersection between visual storytelling means and literary, of course. But it differs from both of them in very different ways. Because with literature, everything is written. So you're sitting here and you're reading what an author is imparting to you. And your job as the reader is to take things from it and understand. Whereas with the visual arts, all you have to do is see. You just have to look and process that. There isn't the mental leap which transforms words into, well, graphics on a page, like little letters themselves are symbols, as it were. So you have to see these, transform them in your mind into the ideas. Whereas with visual arts, it's already there. But comics can do something rather unique in that it can combine the two in different ways. Because one of the great powers of visual medium is if you're seeing, for instance, the famous, something like Picasso even, The Crying Woman, you instantly feel the surge of emotion from looking at it because you're seeing a woman crying. Whereas, of course, in literature, it has to be described to you. And it takes up entirely different parts of the brain to get to the emotional core. Mm-hmm. But with comics, you can do both. You can do neither. You can have a picture of somebody feeling emotions, or you can describe somebody feeling emotions at the same time. And so it offers a way to communicate to the reader that is entirely different from both visual art, be it theatre or paintings or anything like that, and also different from literature. And when you've got a master storyteller like Howard, he is the reason I believe he is so prolific in comics is because it is so easy to visualize his works. And another aspect is with the visual mediums like theater or cinema, you're very passive. You have to watch the story as it unfolds. With a painting or with literature, you have all the time in the world. You can just look at any part of the painting you like, or you can read one paragraph for an entire day, read it over and over. And with comics, again, you can do both. You can look at one panel, or you can speed through it. It's all up to you, the pacing. You can choose what you focus on. Whereas something like a film or a play, you know, the actors themselves have full control over that. And so it's that essence of the audience having control over how they interpret something. And comics are quite remarkable in that level, that depth of interaction. And of course, the Conan comics are some of the best examples of that. Right back to the Tower of the Elephant in the original, which I think is, it's brilliant, of course. And but as a result, it's difficult to describe in a lot of ways, oddly enough.
Well, as a creator, the creator has the choice of deciding which of Howard's words they're going to use as prose and which of Howard's words they're going to turn into pictures.
Exactly. That's
there's a freedom in that.
There is. And that's one of the fascinating things about adaptations because, well, me, I'm like Tim. I'm very much a purist when it comes to direct Howard adaptations. With pastiches, I think I can have a bit more leeway because, you know, for example, we've got Joe Lansdale. He's doing a Joe Lansdale comic starring Conan. And perfectly valid and, why the hell not, as it were. But with Tim Truman, I think it's very difficult when you're given the task of adapting something because everyone has a completely different interpretation when they're reading a story. And I think that's where a lot of the controversies can sometimes arise because we've all had completely different lives from each other and we read so many different stories and have so many different experiences that we draw forth different things. And the job of the adapter is different from the job of the pastiche, I think. And
yeah,
the beauty of it is
different skills.
Even if you disagree, it's not bad, because it's not that they're doing something wrong, it's that they're doing something different. Mm-hmm. And c'est la vie, what was the vive la difference, I suppose. I apologize to Patrice Louinet in absentia for my mangling.
for butchering is the French.
Yes, of course.
Well, you know, there's an elephant in the room right now, and that's the current Queen of the Black Coast storyline that Brian Wood and Mickey Cloonan are doing. This has come under, I would call it, virulent controversy and scrutiny from the Howard community, even as people who have never read a Conan comic before are reading it going, this is great, I love it, Brian Wood's a genius. For the purposes of this panel, this is how I feel about it. I used to be very angry that the only Conan I could get was Conan by somebody else. Now that Conan is available in those three wonderful little Del Rey books, and it's all cleaned up and it's all nice, and they're even illustrated, bonus. Now that that's available and it's stayed in print through multiple printings, and they're keeping it in print, it's part of this library, and I can buy it in hardcover, softcover, ebook, audiobook. It's available and it's out there. I say, open the gates up. You know, sure, if you want me to do a Conan, I'll do a Conan story. It may not be what you want to see. It'll definitely be my honest, here's everything I like about Conan. But as long as everybody knows, first of all, I have no intention of putting it right next to Robert E. Howard's and going, this is part of that world. It's also in no way, shape, or form trying to diminish anything that Howard did. And it's because the original stuff's out there. You know, same thing with Sherlock Holmes is a perfect example. There's a couple of really left of field interpretations of Sherlock Holmes right now. But you know what? Anybody that doesn't want to see that, there's the books, there's the Basil Rathbones, there's the Jeremy Brett.
It's why people read the originals, though.
That's right.
Yeah. Yes.
I mean, a lot of people, when Lynn Carter and all those people did those books, I'd never heard of Conan before. Mm-hmm.
Right.
I read The Wolf's Head, you know, there was a little paperback of that, and I thought, who's this? And it had them, and then had, you know, Robert E. Howard, and then them, and I started reading. That's what led me to it.
Yes. Yeah.
And I just want to say something. I'm going to butt in just a little bit, because I'm going to say something about Tim. It's not fair. He's my brother, so it's not nice. But of all of the people that I've read that have done comics, I think his are the closest to the material.
Yeah.
And I also think that he's the best comic book artist that's done it. Now, a lot of people might argue who's the prettiest or whatever, but I think, and I don't say this because he's here, but I think he's the greatest comic book artist alive. And I'll tell you why. He paid me a lot of money. I think he's the best comic book artist alive because he's the only one that, to me, when I look at the comics, they move.
Yes.
I have done comics with people who done art that looks like it ought to be hung in a gallery, but it's an individual series of frames.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I think that Tim has that magic of telling a story through. You could take out all of my words and it wouldn't be nearly as good. Tim will tell you this. I'd write things where I didn't have anything in them. And I just said, okay, this is what's happening. And then Tim could do it. But he could do that.
Yeah.
And he would often change it to make it fit.
Right.
But when you read his story, you could take out all the words and you know what's going on.
Yeah.
That's comic book artist. That's a real...
It is cinematic.
It's a real movie.
That's cinematic quality. And,
sorry, I had to get that in.
It's how Joe Kubert taught me. That's true. He said, can this be printed in Spanish? Can your work be printed in Spanish? And people will still be able to read the story.
Well, and he would know.
That's right, because he got swiped
for
in Spanish. We have about
10 minutes left. Yep. You have four very learned, talkative people up here.
This question is for Tim. How did you feel when you got your first Conan story in Savvy Sword of Conan way back in 1997?
Yeah, well, that was a weird one, too, because I didn't feel like I was actually doing Conan. I was illustrating a story written by my friend at the time, Chuck Dixon. And so it was interesting, but at the time I remember specifically saying, this is not how I see Conan. because you have to follow the template established by, in that case, John Buscema.
Yeah.
And that's always been a big holdup. We were just talking in the yard at the house. It's always been a big holdup with me because I always want to do my interpretation of Conan, but I can't get there because I have this vestiges of, Frazetta and Buscema back there in particular, and that sort of established that template. And someday I might be able to do it. I think at the community center, I think they have some sketches I did, and I hopefully they reprinted a commission I did for a fan once, and it comes closest to what I see. And also the poster, I will agree with Joe on that they did a special poster for this thing. Dark Horse contributed, and that gets close to what I see. But I see him real different. I see him with a boxer's physique. He looks like Jack Dempsey, you know. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And it's a working, fighting man's physique. It isn't a bodybuilder,
right? Yeah.
So, just kind of.
I would think that as an artist, that would be the absolute hardest thing to do is shake those iconic.
Yeah.
You know,
really different.
Because whether it's Winsor Smith or Buscema or Frazetta. You know, and I'm always amazed. The guy that amazed me the most recently, your Conan was great, and that kind of goes without saying. Gary Gianni's Conan was one of the ones where I went, here's a guy who figured out a way to do his version of Conan without hitting anybody else or bumping into him, and that's brutal. You know, for so many people, whether you saw him on the side of a van or a Molly Hatchet cover or, you know, whatever, you know, your first Conan was probably the Conan that you loved the most, you know, whether it was Schwarzenegger or it was one of the paperbacks with the great Frazetta covers. I mean, it's very hard to shake that because when you first read Howard, it's like a bolt of lightning going through you and you never forget it. You know, it's usually a kind of a touchstone moment. It's certainly for all of us in the room, it is.
Yeah. You know, those old Weird Tales illustrations were different. He's like,
absolutely.
Yeah, especially the Margaret Brundage pastels.
Actually, I think Neil Adams was my first image of Conan. It was the record. I had the Power Records, Neil Adams, Crawler from the Mist.
What an image to get.
I don't want to take up too much of that, but about interpretation.
Yep.
This is an illustration about interpretation. I taught at Pennsylvania College of Art and Design, and one of the assignments I would have the kids to do would be I'd get one student here and another student here that have these drawing, big pads of paper, face so they couldn't see what each other was drawing. And I would take a script and I would read to them like a description of a character. I would say, you know, or a monster or whatever. I'd say, okay, draw this. And because when we read things, we think that everyone else perceives it the same way we do.
Right.
It was an absolutely crystalline moment for a lot of the students, because when the people would finally turn their drawing boards around, of course, the people in the audience could see what they were drawing, and they were just like amazed, you know. And the artists were like looking at people's faces and like, you know, why are they making those faces about what we're drawing? And so when they turn them around so they could see each other's work, the differences, even though they were being read exactly the same description, the differences were astounding. They're, you know, just how they were processing the information. So it taught the students, as artists, like how much of that personal connection with material and how much artistic processing goes into filtering through the words, you know.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
I mean, it was just, it was pretty astounding. I've done the same things on giving them scripts, you know, panel to panel scripts. And everybody's working from the same material, but they're seeing things in absolutely amazingly different ways. So that's one of that sort of goes back to what,
Just to throw in a quick plug, too, for what's currently going on. In my opinion, I think what Tomas is doing, too, you know, as far as artists, I think he's, you know, as far as current artists doing Howard stuff, he's nailing it. He really is. Tomas Giorello, who's doing the art now for the King Conan series with Tim. If you have not picked up
these and see what they're doing. It's really, he's doing just great work.
There's even some great copies at the gift shop with Scarlet Citadel and Phoenix on the Sword.
Pick this up in the gift shop.
Oh, they have the first issue. I'm plugging it here. I will consciously plug it. They do have the first issue of Hour of the Dragon, the first issue of it, but the proceeds go to help the.
I was also talking about how good an artist he is, but his writing on the recent ones. No, I'm talking about the Songs of the Dead actually, but on this the stuff writing, I think nails the stuff better than anybody.
I agree.
And I know he worries about that because you talk to me, say, "Yeah, I'm going to have to not. I can't do that because of that." And people don't know that don't do this stuff. Why things sometimes are what they are.
Yeah. There's a lot of conversation that goes on before you see that finished comic.
There's a lot of mental turmoil too.
Right.
Where it really is a Howard fan.
Guys, we're going to be talking about this all weekend. We're out of time right now. Thank you for coming to the first panel. There's more stuff going.
Thank you, everybody.
Tim's here all weekend. Joe's here all weekend. And so please hang around. There's a lot more coming. Thanks a lot for being here, guys.